Hi there, and welcome back to our daily Advent devotional for Monday, December 7th, 2020. I hope that you're finding some benefit from these. As a person who's not a big fan of being in front of the camera, doing this is a little uncomfortable, and yet I have found great joy in doing them, and I hope that you are getting some benefit from it as well. Well, today is, as I said, Monday the 7th, and we're going to go to the Advent calendar. Piece of chocolate. Got to save that for later. And we also have a Bible verse. And so today I want to share you our Bible verse. It's 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 11, which says, "Therefore, encourage one another and build up each other, as indeed you are doing." What a wonderful sentiment. Certainly, this is a season of joy and hopefully one of encouragement. And it reminds me of a story that I want to share from you from another book. Oh, I love books. Maybe you can tell. This one is called 100 Amazing Things About Christmas. And in particular, this one appeals to me on a couple of different levels. Some of you may know that I am a second generation Army brat. So the military is a big part of my heritage. And so I like this particular story. Some of you may be familiar with an organization called NORAD, which, if I remember correctly, is the North American Defense Command. I don't remember exactly what it stands for. Well, its predecessor, which was known as CONAD, back on Christmas Eve 1955, was led by an Air Force colonel by the name of Harry Shoup. And Harry Shoup had on his desk a red phone. Now, for our older viewers, you probably know what I mean by a red phone. A red phone was always designated as a direct line of communication for important military matters. Most of us think of the red phone as being communication directly between the U.S. president and the leader of the USSR, the Soviet Union, especially back in the 50s, and a means of being able to keep communication open and to avoid any misunderstandings that could lead to potential world war. Well, red phones were used in the military for all sorts of things to provide direct communication between important levels of government. And CONAD at that time had a red phone that led to the Pentagon. Well, the red phone rang. That's not a good sign as a general rule. And so this Colonel Harry Shoup answered it, expecting that the Pentagon was calling to perhaps warn them about a potential threat. Instead, when he picked up the phone, there was the voice of a little girl on the line. And her question was, "Are you really Santa Claus?" Oof. Now, military officers sometimes get a bad rap. They're so caught up in important decisions that are valuable for saving people's lives that they can sometimes be a little gruff. But fortunately for this little girl and for our story, this Colonel Shoup, instead of scolding the little girl and wondering how she had gotten the phone number, was instead a little more amused by the situation. And so instead, he played along and he reported that yes, he was indeed Santa, and he reviewed with her her wish list and encouraged her to leave food for both Santa and his reindeer. Well, the phone call wasn't a prank, and it wasn't anybody trying to cause problems, but rather a Colorado Springs newspaper had printed the number by accident. It was a typo for them, which was supposed to go to a Sears Roebuck store so that kids could call and speak with Santa, but they had accidentally mixed up the numbers and given out this, legitimate military phone number. Well, the great thing of it is that instead of making a huge issue of it, of the typographical error and causing all these problems, instead it developed into a program that the military continues today. Nowadays we know it as NORAD, and NORAD Tracks Santa is the program. It receives about 155,000 phone calls every Christmas season from kids all over the world, not just the United States or North America, but as far away as Japan and England. And they call in, and now you can not only call, but you can check it online. You can go to Facebook or Twitter or Instagram. You can even use artificial intelligence devices like Amazon's Alexa that will tell you where Santa is. But still, at least 80 calls come in every hour, especially during Christmas Eve. And volunteers answer those calls in order to let people know where Santa is and when they can expect him to arrive at their home. Sometimes they also get other questions like what kind of cookies or treats to leave for Santa. And I want to, I'm hoping that you will share this this tradition. If you haven't already experienced it in the past, I'm going to put the phone number here on the screen, and maybe you can share this with your children or your grandchildren this year. But, you know, that colonel had a choice when he picked up that phone and heard the little girl's voice. He could have gotten very angry. He could have been very gruff with her. He could have caused her to hang up the phone in tears, upset over something that she had no control of. The army, the military, could have gone very hard on the newspaper that had inadvertently posted their phone number, for the red phone no less, in their newspaper for all these people to reach out to. But instead, they took it as an opportunity to encourage and offer some joy in this season. And that reminds me not only of our Bible verse, but also of the transition that we start to see in our beloved character, Ebenezer Scrooge. And so again, from our 52 Little Lessons from A Christmas Carol by Bob Welch, I'm looking at lesson 13 called Your Actions Affect Others. When we finished off last week, we were reminded that Marley, Scrooge's business partner, former business partner, had come back from the dead in order to share his concern that Scrooge was following the same path that he was. And so he promised, or maybe threatened, depending on your point of view, that Scrooge would be visited by three more spirits. The first of those spirits was the spirit of Christmas past. And one of the places that the spirit took Scrooge was to a former employer of his, a man by the name of Fezziwig. Oh, what a great name. I love these names that Dickens comes up with. Fezziwig was apparently pretty jolly. I don't know how he was the rest of the year, but at least on Christmas Eve, he encouraged his young employees, including Ebenezer Scrooge, to go ahead and close the shutters. They were done with work for the day, and they began to transform the workhouse that they were in into a place for a grand party. They pushed back all the tables and chairs. They swept the floor. They brought in all kinds of cakes and pies, roasts and more, invited not just the employees and their families, but about half the town came and joined in the festivities along with Fezziwig and his employees, including a great deal of dancing. And apparently Fezziwig and his wife outdanced them all. Even this early into the story, we start to see a crack in Scrooge's gruff demeanor. We find that he, as an older man, looking back on this scene, is probably enjoying the party and the festivities as much as his younger counterpart did when he lived it out the first time. So much so that the spirit, perhaps while playing devil's advocate and jesting with him, says, "It's a small matter to make these silly folks so full of gratitude." But this response brings up in Scrooge an anger, and he's heated by the remark, Dickens says, and chooses to defend his old boss. And he gives us this speech, and I love, "He has the power to render us happy or unhappy, to make our service light or burdensome, a pleasure or a toil. The happiness he gives is quite as great as if it cost a fortune." Just in those words, in reliving this time, he recognizes the power that we each have in affecting others. He could have, Fezziwig chose to bring out the joy, and he gave joy to others. And Scrooge goes on to say, "I should like to be able to say a word or two to my clerk just now. He's already feeling some regret over the harshness with which he has treated Bob Cratchit, and so we see a crack in his gruff demeanor. Theologian and author Frederick Buechner once wrote this, "If you want to be holy, be kind." And here we see the beginning of that, that holiness means being kind. Scrooge comes to realize, as hopefully we have already, and if not, hear this today, we have the power to make people happy. We have the ability to make them feel valued. Or vice versa, we have the ability to cause them grief or to make them feel unvalued. The bottom line, we make a difference in the lives of other people. And sometimes the biggest difference makers are those who never realize the effect they've had on others. As we go back to our verse in 1 Thessalonians, "Therefore, encourage one another and build up each other." I hope that we too will learn just how important that can be. When we share the joy that we know as followers of Christ, as children of God, we can bring that same joy and life to others. Let us try and do that in this season of Christmas and throughout the whole year. Amen.